I think we had only two presentations, and we will let the other panelists speak now, and then we will open it up to the floor for further discussions. So I'll have Mr. Keshav talk about his experience on O&M. There's one specific question that I have for you, Mr. Keshav. I know that IL&FS usually builds the plant and then does the O&M for 15 years for an end customer. Now, what are some of the parameters from an O&M perspective specifically that you are looking at to enable or to be able to make all the financial numbers that you had put it into your model?
Good morning. Thank you, Monica and Mr. Reddy. I think excellent presentation. I represent IL&FS Energy. We are a leading renewable energy player. More than about 1,000 megawatt of wind and solar and biomass assets. We are also building 5,000 megawatt of solar park. Out of that, about 1,000 megawatt park is under commissioning in the state of Rajasthan. We are also building 200 megawatt of solar assets in state of Karnataka, which is basically towards a unique innovative model in the market where the customer owns the project. And similar to your housing finance or the automobile finance, he pays back over a period of year like an asset deferred payment of the asset consideration. So in coming to the today's topic, what is on the utility scale projects, O&M, from the owner's perspective. I think many of you know that whenever somebody tries to invest, so you look for in your own financial terms of equity returns, how is the cash flow. So, but they remain on paper when you do the bidding and win the project, unless it is effectively acted upon through an O&M, effective O&M. So the O&M, let me address in two forms. One is the traditional O&M, what we all see that today, how the market is shaping up. I think definitely over the last 3 years, we see a lot of analytics, a lot of SCADA automation happening. That is towards sustaining that investment which has been done. So the second part, which is the emerging trend in the O&M, so no more the O&M on its own. There is also an opportunity in the solar sector today. At the same time, there's also a threat. The threat, what I mean, is that today the investment in coal and thermal or gas is virtually drying out, and there is a lobby which tries to see solar or wind as a threat to the grid instability. Maybe true, may not be true as on today, but definitely it will become a reality as we go along. But that's one part of the lobby which is trying to decelerate the investments in the RE. So there are certain genuine issues which they bring up, like in the form of firmness of the renewables. How do we improve that firmness so there's no longer you cannot rely only on renewable. So that's one part of the story. The second is that when that happens, that means the technology of the storage is also emerging. As many of you know that the electric vehicle, there will be a revolution in a few years from down the line. So once that happens, in parallel the energy storage through batteries will be a reality, and already it is becoming a reality where you use it for grid management purposes. So I personally feel that a couple of years you will see the trend coming into solar, and you will see that solar gaining strength. So that whatever the threat is there today, or the people projecting it as a disadvantage, will work in its favor, and you will see the solar plants no longer become a traditional, as and when sun comes, it generates power. So it's not that that paradigm shift you will see over the next few years, where solar will become like a firm power, and it will address some of the grid related issues which it is potentially creating. So now that paradigm shift brings a tremendous change expectation on the O&M side. So coming to the first part, which is basically the traditional O&M which is happening today. I think when an owner or an investor decides to invest, so he looks at, you know, how do I get more generation on a daily basis, hourly basis, how do I get more generation? Now, of course, that gets translated into revenue, then to your cash flows, then to your equity returns, all that fine. But in a layman's language, how do we generate more from a unit of radiation? That means every hour or every radiation hour, what you get from sun, how can I get more out of it? So this is one part. But there are many, you know, what you call building blocks to reach that level. It's not as simple as we imagine. And also, as I think Monica mentioned on the PR. PR is something, you know, it's very, very difficult for investors to understand. So some numbers will be there, but is PR is a true reflection where one can, you know, drive the performance indirectly, directly. So there are a lot of, you know, what you call complexities around PR, you know, to prove that it's right, wrong, all that. So ultimately, I think the investors today, they are looking at a simple parameter where you say that every unit of sun radiation, what I have got in terms of 1000 kilowatt hour per kilowatt hour per meter square, what is the generation I can get? I think the industry will emerge towards a metrics which is easy to understand. So that's one part. And how do we build this? Build this is through, as she mentioned, how do you build that through the design assurance at the design stage, selecting the right material, right design, right you know, combination of sizing of systems, and then go to the voltage drops which are there within the system. How do we minimize that? Then you go to the at the time of suppliers. How do you choose the suppliers? How do you ensure that those parameters what you intended are meeting? Then you go to the construction. How do you use best practices to build the plant? How do you ensure that what you have designed is in line with what you are constructing now? So then you go to the operation maintenance. So that's that the what we believe from design to supplier to construction, I think one should approach a CTQ approach. So from the quality perspective, where you identify critical to quality parameters, you look at each of those parameters in the chain and make sure they are interlinked, they have been assessed, they are within the you know, window of tolerance, and ensure that what you intended is what you have actually built. So I'm not sure in the 16,000 megawatt what India has built, the developers have a consistent approach. So she mentioned about the lab, that lab approach, what mobile lab, where you see that the technology which is going in, it looks, solar looks very simple from outside, but when we go into the depth, there are a lot of nitty-gritties and nuances one needs to take care, otherwise you are bedded with for next 25 years. So, and some things which are done already, it is very difficult to undo. So now that's the total cycle, you know, attention in terms from design to construction and to O&M is most crucial. Then we look at, you know, what can we influence? You come to the O&M. So obviously there are lead indicators, lag indicators, what you have. So one need not, you know, from an O&M operator perspective, he needs to focus on some of the, you know, proactive measures, what he needs to do. The proactive are on an hourly basis, daily basis, weekly basis, monthly basis. There has to be a rigorous discipline and system that is followed in that O&M. And the some of the parameters like, you know, how do we ensure that cleaning cycle, having derived an optimum cycle, how do we ensure that each panel goes through that cycle, whether it is 10-day cycle, 15-day cycle, 7-day cycle, or it could be a daily cycle. So that could be one parameter one needs to focus. Then you have the quality of water. I think many people don't focus on quality of water. The quality of water has a direct bearing on the performance of the panel over its lifetime, because the glass which is used on the solar panel has certain coating as well as has certain optical properties. So the water quality has a significant bearing on its surface in the form of scaling. So, and also there could be some areas where over water logging also creates some fungus. So these parameters, if it is not taken care in terms of water softness, that is bound to impact the performance of the plant. Then you have Nowadays, water itself need not be used. There could be glasses where it has anti-soiling properties. It could be glasses which have a wider spectrum response. The waterless cleaning could be there, or it could be other forms of cleaning. So now these areas, one needs to make sure that while it addresses the performance, it doesn't affect the reliability of the system over its lifetime. Then you look at the critical spare availability, preventive maintenance, uptime, auxiliary consumption is another interesting area where we believe that today the plants are built anywhere from 0.5 to 0.8% of the energy what it generates is lost in the form of its own self-consumption and also maybe transmission losses. Now, how do we minimize this? Now, more and more DISCOMs are also becoming more smarter. Earlier, they used to net off with the solar generation what used to do. Now, they are telling that no, it has to be paid separately. It has to be a commercial tariff or an industrial tariff, whatever you need to pay. That means because the solar tariffs have become cheaper. Now, as a result of which, I think there's also another trend which one needs to see, where the solar plants will be independent of drawing power from the grid. So such a scenario will help in optimizing the cost, optimizing the losses. Other proactive, these are all the routine measures one needs to take. I think on the proactive initiatives, one needs to look at the preventive health checkup through the diagnostics, could be drone based. So most important is we are getting equipped with all these tools and techniques, but ultimately what happens, how do you build those learnings? Suppose you say there is a 15 module breakage, 20 module problem there. Now, how do you translate that contractually? How do you convince your module supplier that it is because of him? So this dispute resolution is a major challenge, which when you go through it, then you look at the how do you optimize the cable losses within the plant. There could be a correction in the tilt or the mismatch in strings is another common area where when solar is still modular, but when you take a 100 megawatt plant, you may have maybe 400,000 modules type. So lakhs of those modules, how do you ensure that when they are connected in series, how there are no losses within the string? So this selecting the panels at a current matching as close as possible, ensuring that mismatch losses in the plant is much lower. So today, if you see, is about almost 20-25% from the time you the sun hits the sun and from the time you reach the grid. So that is the loss. So the more you, that is a very significant number. So the more saving you do in that, that will translate into your revenue earnings and the returns. So last, I think the O&M as a discipline, as a business, is transforming. We believe that the firmness requirement of renewables and solar in particular will be fast addressed through certain control systems, where you have the energy storage built as a part of the solar plant, and the peak load issues which are there in the supply demand side, and the frequency regulations and the grid instability issues, and the short-term peaks which you require, all these can be easily met by solar using control mechanisms, where you, apart from doing the forecasting part, demand planning part, so it also needs to, so the solar will no longer become an island of power generation. It interacts with the grid, it interacts with the load, and it responds flexibly. So that is the stage where the solar utility scale, I'm sure, will reach that level, and that's the great future as an industry and as a technology. And I think India has embarked on the right time. All these global developments are integrating into India. India has an opportunity to implement. I wish you all the best. Thank you.
I also like the idea that we probably need to move away from PR to a generation-based number. Unfortunately, the other side, which is the EPC, commitment of an absolute generation numbers becomes very, very difficult, because the main resource which helps you create that generation, which is irradiation, is something that you have no control on. But an interesting thought, I'm sure the industry would look towards how do we move away from PR to a generation-based number. With that, I will request Mr. Onkar, who is the CEO for Sitac, if you can throw some ideas around what is that you are looking at from an O&M perspective, be it a new install base or an existing install base. What are the performance parameters that you would be kind of looking at?
Hello.
Yes.
As you know, the in solar plant, nothing is moving. So what I am facing when I am just looking, because I am from power sector and thermal, other, when my power thermal plant unit trip, it has just boiler give the steam pressure valve operate, and total plant operator to general manager knows there is some problem, and everybody will catch to come to the control room without informing. But what is happening in this solar plant, there is nothing like that. Nothing is moving, nothing is stopped. So the feeling between the plant performance and human psychology is an issue. And because this is our first generation which is learning how in mobile or in screen data, you have to get the sense something is going good or something is going bad. So the total generation is in this process, and solar is also part of that. So issue is that, like, my some string inverter is not working, some few segment of panels are not working, but it does not have any sense in the control room or something. And because the things are very small in string level or inverter level, that is also not we get the proper attention immediately. What I'm feeling in the ground basically, and because like if you have a 50 mega plant and one string is not working, so 50 kilowatt, it is only the what you say less than 1%. So this is one challenge for the O&M. And second thing is our who is dealing with the O&M, they should have the perspective of the 25 year, because we have to what we will do in first few years and how we will keep take care of the equipments and how we'll abuse the machines or parts, that will have the impact in the later part of the project. Because we have seen in the other sector like thermal how the people have operated the plant, and after 10 years, 15 years, the replacement cost becoming high and high. And another thing, what is the about the generation? Now, I'm just looking in not in India, but in other countries, the EPC players are offering the generation, annual generation in place of PR. But yes, it is compared to low, but when I am as an investor, we know how low things can go and we can take a call. So if it is like industry is working on 80% PR or 79%, they are saying in any 25 year you will get say 76 or 77% PR generation, and that will be in unit base, it is not the on percentage base. So that will give more confidence to the IPP basically. And because when the tariffs are going like this 2 point something, you have to squeeze every corner, and this is also where the IPP or EPC is just keeping every some little thing in their pockets for future. Right, thank you.
I think Mr. Onkar mentioned something nice about more from less. So we have to ensure how do we squeeze out maximum out of the same solar asset. One thing which comes out of this is, he mentioned that there is no moving plant in the plant, but we have seen a technology shift, at least specifically last year, from fixed tilt system to tracker systems. And I know that Ostro has used a lot of tracker plants. So I would open it up to Mr. Mathusudhan to mention something about what are the kind of challenges or how easy or difficult it is to operate a plant with trackers specifically.
Good morning all. Thanks, Monica. So just I will give my introduction and I will answer to our question. So myself, S.K.Mathu Sudhana. So I started my career in NTPC and worked in steam turbine maintenance, hardcore windham guy. And after that, I went to Adani, in that too in a thermal plant, and that is the first supercritical in India. Then post that, I joined Ostro a couple of years back. And in Ostro, we have around 1000 megawatt of wind and 110 megawatt of solar. So the both the solar plants, one is in 50 megawatt in Telangana and 60 megawatt in Rajasthan. Both are different geographical locations and the environment is different. And so coming to the solar industry and what I understand from the renewable industry, from the thermal perspective. See, Mr. Onkar has said that the way the thermal unit operates, if a unit trips, the safety valve pop-ups and total crowd came to know that and everybody runs to the control room. Similarly, as a steam turbine guy, I keep my team and ourselves very vigil that the equipment is safe and why it has tripped, what is the reason. We go each and every trip with a total root cause analysis and we ensure that the unit is operative and a full better availability, right? Each and every day has a minimum loss of 5 crores, so people have to answer for that. So in unlikely that wind and solar, maybe the losses may be in terms of 1000 rupees or 100,000 rupees, so people may not have that kind of tension while seeing a breakdown or some DC cable fault is there or some module is not working, some cables are disconnected, some fuses are blown out. Maybe the losses may not you may not have that kind of feel that you are at a loss. But in thermal industry, people are, the plant has to operate at 100% availability, 100% PLF is required, and a loss is huge. And any mistake which is repeatable is not at all acceptable, and you will spoil your name in the industry. And any small mistake, you will have a loss of 30 days, 40 days in steam turbines. So the reliability, the dedication, the interest, the technology, the engineering part is much addressed in thermal industry. And the O&M is done by most of the people, by the owners itself. So unlikely we will take a call of OEM at a very, very some instances. But when I joined Ostro, so I come across the wind industry. So wind industry is slightly different from solar. So wind industry is like a black box. So people will not reveal what is there inside the box, and they will give you a guarantee. I will maintain those asserts, and I will give you 96% resource availability. I will give 97.5% availability, but they don't care. You know, even though your machine is available, when there is no wind, there is no use. So when they do maintenance, when there is a wind, it's a loss to you. It's not loss to them. So it is a trade-off, and we need to, every time we need to have a put pressure on the OEMs or the contractors to not to take any shutdowns during the high wind. But it is something different in solar, where solar is technically nothing is moving. It's very simple. It's completely electrical. If a guy knows electrical much better and deeper, can easily maintain a solar plant. And the person who knows how to manage manpower can easily do the solar maintenance. But the solar is more predictive, very easy, morning 6 to evening 6, and most of the maintenance plan in the night. So giving a broad about the O&M, just so coming to the solar only. So you know that from 2010 only, the India have really thought about investing in solar, and government has started a closed competitive bidding. The initial prices were around 17 rupees, 18 rupees per unit. Now the cost is reduced to around 2.44 per unit. And your capex costs have go low, as low as less than 4 crores per megawatt. Your O&M cost during that time was around 10 to 11 lakhs per megawatt per year. But right now it is less than 5 lakhs, even it is less. So I do not want to give the exact number, but it is less than even 4 lakh per megawatt per year. So you understand the competitiveness and the mission of India to reach around 1 lakh megawatt of solar in a very short span of time. So giving to the other perspective, see, everybody are discussing about the O&M. It is like buying a Mercedes Benz or buying a Maruti, which is value for money, and giving to a key to a driver. Driver is a O&M contractor or a O&M guy. The way he drives the car, the way he maintains the car for a 25 years will give you the thing. Whether you buy a Mercedes Benz or you buy a Maruti, anything. So you know that what is the tariff, you have made a model, and you know what is your returns. So the way you maintain for a long-term perspective, 25 years is the key, and how you manage the assets. There is a requirement, there is a need to given a proper hands to understand that loss is a loss, whether it is a small or a big. The intention is should be very clear. The people have to address the smallest of small issues. So we agree that solar is not a small thing. It may be spread across acres of land, and human visual monitoring, it will be difficult. Even you go around a complete thorough inspection, you will take weeks of weeks time to make a thorough inspection. So if you unnoticed a problem in somewhere in a location, so that will be creating a loss for weeks time, maybe days time, so maybe 2 long hours, right? So maybe in a thermal plant or maybe in a wind industry where immediately you will get a notification, you get an error, you will get to know why the machine is tripped, you will address immediately. So where your MTTR is so low, but compared to solar, until unless you do not have a SCADA system, you do not follow a IoT system where a big data analytics is helping you, assisting you, so your real O&M contractor or manpower cannot have a better O&M practice at the ground. Right. So coming to Ostro, so we actually we deploy O&M based contract systems. So we deploy actually Mahindra in both the sites. So in Telangana we have a fixed, we both have actually fixed tilt based solar modules we have. In Telangana the soiling loss is less than 1% or 1 to 1.5%. So there the water availability was there, but the water quality TDS was higher, so we installed our plant. So as rightly said, the quality of water should be as important as very important, because the TDS, if you use more than 400-500 over a period of time, your module will get degraded. So most of us know that what kind of degradation usually happen for a polycrystalline. So approximately it is 0.7% every year. In the initial year you will be losing around 2.5%, then post that you will be having a loss of 0.7% continuously over a period of say 20 years 25 years. So that means 80% you will land up on 80%. But if you do not manage your panel module cleaning with the proper water, then the degradation will be very fast, and there will be a tussle between the panel manufacturer and you whether how to get the claim, whether you are using a proper water or not, whether you have a records or not. So those kind of things will be there. Coming to my Rajasthan site, so we take a call using a, because the in Rajasthan the availability of water is also less, as well as the dust, the conditions are very soily, so the soil loss was as good as the 3%. So we take a management call. So we do not want to use a water-based cleaning system. So most of the neighbor solar sites were using water so far, till now. But we took a call to put a robot cleaning system. So we found that it is not so costly affair, and the maintenance is also okay. And we have given a turnkey project to the, I can say the name, it is Ecopia. So we are using that robot cleaning, and it has two major advantages. One is you do not require water, and if you use water cleaning, your cleaning cycle will be approximately fortnightly. That means 15 days once you will be cleaning, twice a month. But if you use a robot cleaning, it is a daily. So every day your module is being cleaned by the robots. And the other next important point is the protective coating. There is an anti-reflective coating is there on the module, glass module. So that will go away if you use water jet, high pressure water jet to use. If you clean that module, that anti-protective layer will go away, which will give you a loss of approximately 1% in PR. Second, the last one is the manpower. So if you want to manually clean the complete area of 300 acres, 200 acres of panels, so it takes more time, and you need to manage manpower and contractors, tankers, etc., etc., local ROW issue, many issue will come which is attached to that kind of cleaning systems. So by using the robot system, it is completely automatic, and a person can operate by a laptop. It is, everything is Wi-Fi connected. So that is being done every day, and there is a contractually agreed increase in efficiency of 1.5% in terms of generation. So from a normal cleaning by water and by using a robot cleaning system, I am guaranteed to get more than 1.5% in terms of generation. So that is a huge benefit, and I am reducing drastically the requirement of manpower. I am using local best technology available, and I am ensuring that my modules are cleaned every day. And that too in the area where the sandstorms and dust is very, very high in nature in Rajasthan. So this is about. And coming to the maintenance point, typical wind-down guy maintenance, right? So one is the monitoring part. So how I understand my equipments. So when I compare with the abroad and Indian mindset of erections or construction quality, even in thermal or even in solar or even in wind, the Indian's mindset is just timeline, target, last minute job, and using unskilled labor force, using any L1 contractors, and finally we will end up in nowhere. And the people will say, I am completed my project, my generation is started, and now O&M will take over. This is the normal mindset. And I can give an example of Doosan. You might have heard Doosan. So our team of members visited their site and plant in Korea, South Korea. So there they visited the boiler penthouse. You know, most of the people might have seen a thermal power plant where normally a boiler will be fully filled with ash dust, coal dust, multiple dust will be there. And that too in penthouse, nobody can go without a nose mask or dust mask. But our team, just shocked by seeing a penthouse, they are telling that we can have a meal or a dinner at the penthouse itself. Normally in turbine area, it's a so clean atmosphere. The same atmosphere was visible in the boiler, and that too in a penthouse area. So nothing else. It is the same contractor, same technology. It's nothing difference in terms of technology. The technology remains same, but the way we install, way we erect, way we lay the cable underground, nobody knows, God knows. And what will happen to the O&M? We cannot do a re-erection of the complete project. So we have to live with the project. So that is more important that how you do a proper erection, use your best of the best team with a full quality. Don't just try to compromise on quality. If you compromise on quality during the erection phase, then that is a problem for the lifetime. And the problem will keep on coming, and people will keep on doing a reactive maintenance, and that is will be keep on continuing. So the people will not have time to even think about the proactive maintenance or any advancement, any improvement in the project. So normally it takes 2 through 3 years to make a stabilization in any project. So this is one request to all.